is the moment I have been waiting for and you all have been waiting for as we take over 91X, the famous rock station of San Diego. Millions of people are listening, and one thing that I wanted to do from day one when they asked me to take over the station was the first person I thought of was this gentleman named James Fetzer. And the reason was is one night I was up late with my wife listening to Coast AM, which is a show that's on all night long. A talk radio show, and it usually is diving deep into subjects that people never talk about. And the one that was on this night was all about the conspiracies of 9/11. But the interesting thing was, is nothing about it seemed like a conspiracy. It all seemed like it was fact, and it all seemed as though this is really what happened. It wasn't just some weird idea that a bunch of kids are thinking up in a garage out in Illinois or something, but... Here we go. This is James H. Fetzer. He is a distinguished McKnight University Professor of Philosophy at the University of Minnesota, Duluth, a former Marine Corps officer, the author or editor of more than 27 books, and is the founder and co-chair of Scholars for the 9/11 Truth. Hello, James.
Hey, Alex. Great to be on with you.
Well, thank you so much. What I want to do now is I want to get into this. I'm just going to let you talk. I'm going to let the people driving just listen for a second. Tell us how you got into this, and then just go.
Well, I got into this because the government appears to have been dishing out nothing but lies and deception about the events of 9/11 and then using them to manipulate us to achieve its political purposes. I founded a group of experts and scholars that are devoted to exposing the falsehoods and revealing the truths about 9/11, and what we found will make your hair spin. We discovered, for example, that everything the government has said is just fine as long as you're willing to believe impossible things. The planes that hit the buildings caused minimal impact because they were designed to withstand the impact of the largest then commercial airliners, which were Boeing 707s, very similar to the 767s that actually hit the building. Frank DeMartini, who was the project manager on the construction of these buildings, observed that they had sophisticated load redistribution capabilities, largely because of 47 core columns that extended the full height of the 110 floors, and that because of that, if a plane hit the building, its impact would be like sticking a pencil through mosquito netting. Now, those aren't my words. Those are his, sticking a pencil through mosquito netting. So evidently, the planes didn't cause the towers to come down. The fires were actually relatively modest. Now, it turns out that the melting point of steel is 2,800 degrees Fahrenheit. That's quite a substantial temperature. The highest temperature these jet fuel-based fires can reach, however, is only 1,800 degrees Fahrenheit, 1,000 degrees too short to be able to cause the steel to melt. So the steel did not melt. It has been suggested, therefore, that the buildings came down because the fires weakened the steel. Underwriters Laboratory, however, had certified the steel used in these buildings up to 2,000 degrees for 6 hours. Now, the fires were actually relatively modest. They were actually oxygen-starved, so that maximum temperature of 1,800 degrees would only be achieved if you were, say, force-feeding pure oxygen into the fire. You can tell even, and this is one of the smoking guns from 9/11, the dark billowing clouds of fire are indicative of an oxygen-starved fire burning at a much lower temperature. So that Underwriters Laboratory, which certified that steel to 2,000 degrees for 6 hours, estimated that the fires were actually only burning around 500 degrees Fahrenheit,
and this
much
is
too low to even weaken.
And this is an interesting thing. So basically what you're describing is when they made these buildings and when all the planners and engineers and architects got together, they planned for these things to be able to withstand a certain amount of force, and they also planned for the steel to be able to withstand incendiary temperatures for an extended period of time, which there's no way ever got met on this day.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. Not only did the fires not get hot enough, but they didn't burn long enough. For example, the South Tower, which was hit first, hit second, but fell first, after only about an hour. So it was only 1 hour, not up to 6 hours. When they'd been certified up to 6 hours, the South Tower fell after only 1 hour, and the North Tower hit first but fell second. The fires only burned for about an hour and a half. So it's much too short a period of time for the steel to have heated to such a point that it would have even weakened. Steel, of course, is a good thermal conductor, meaning if you try to heat up one part of it, you can't just heat up a section. It distributes the heat throughout the entire beam, so you have to have the whole floor more or less be heated up before it could possibly weaken or collapse. And here those conditions were simply not met.
That's I'm blown away by a number of things, and a lot of people have noticed that when those planes hit the World Trade Center, and there's so much I'm sure you know, I don't even know really where to begin, but it's even when you deal with the idea that these people learned how to fly small planes or small jets and then got into one of those gigantic planes and somehow knew how to veer it off course and hit a pinpoint target however many miles away, none of this stuff makes sense. Tell us some more stuff.
You're absolutely right on. We have members of the society who are pilots and aeronautical engineers who have concluded that these guys could not possibly have flown those planes. They would have trouble taking a small Cessna or a Piper Cub up and down. But as far as the Twin Towers are concerned, they would have been most unlikely to have been able to hit those targets. That requires actually very skillful flying. Oddly, George W. Bush remarked early on that when he saw the plane hit one of those towers, he said that was really a terrible pilot. Well, what's interesting about that is he has to have made that remark before he knew the second tower was hit, or he'd be interpreting the whole matter in a completely different way, which suggests that he had to have access to footage that the rest of us didn't have that enabled him to see a plane hitting that North Tower before any of us knew what was going on or a plane hit the second tower. That's very, very odd. But the rate of fall of the buildings is very striking. If I'd gone to the top of one of these buildings and dropped a grand piano off of the building, it would have come down and hit the ground and then blown up into pieces when it hit the ground with a lot of debris flying upward in about 10 seconds. Those buildings came down in 10 seconds, which means they came down at the same rate as if there were no resistance whatsoever. And this is most important. And the other smoking gun, in addition to those dark billowing clouds, there's this huge cloud of very fine dust and debris that envelops the buildings from the top down. And that is caused by converting the concrete that was used as a flooring material, but also all the office equipment, the desks, the chairs, the computers, into very fine particles, tiny, tiny particles of dust that required a tremendous explosive force the government can't explain. These buildings, Alex, were exploding from the top down at the same rate as if there had been no resistance between them and the ground whatsoever. They're exploding from the top
entire
down.
Building.
Peculiar.
It's like the entire building, it's almost like the structure wasn't even intact from that floor all the way down, is what you're saying.
That's right. And when people wonder how this could have happened, it turns out there's security lapses in the building for the 2 weeks before 9/11.
I heard you say this. Let's talk about this for a second. This blows my mind because this seems to add. I remember when I heard you speak before, and you had another gentleman with you, when you kind of piece apart the way the buildings exploded, it seemed to echo the way big buildings are demolition. And then you bring up the idea that the security systems that would monitor the inside of these buildings for a few weeks prior to 9/11 weren't even intact. Is that true?
Yeah, well, actually, all the security safeguards were being shut down in different parts of the building during the 2 weeks before. But the employees were told to go home, and teams of so-called engineers were